Good afternoon. I'm Adrian Dix, BC Minister of Health. Beside me is our Provincial Health Officer, Dr. Bonnie Henry. We're honored to be here on the territories of the Songhees and Esquimalt First Nations of the Kwangwun-speaking peoples. And tomorrow will be briefing from here at 3 o'clock. It'll just be tomorrow Dr. Henry. On Thursday it'll be Dr. Henry and I, and then we'll continue to be briefing at the same time at 3 o'clock the rest of the week, all of that from here in Victoria, in order to limit the overall amount of travel that we're all doing. That's a new necessity. I want to thank our ASL interpreters, Nigel Howard, and the whole team that's been involved in that, who have done an extraordinary job. And with that, I'd like to introduce Dr. Henry for today's update.
Thank you and good afternoon. For today's update, we're catching up a little bit because we had an early morning or earlier morning briefing yesterday. So I will be giving you reporting on the last two 24-hour periods from Sunday afternoon until this morning. To start off with then, so the total number of new cases that we've had in that period of time is 145. So that was 67 new cases on March 23rd. And in the last 24 hours through to this morning, another 78 positives. So our total now in British Columbia of test positive cases is 617. And I will say that we've been through the backlog of testing, and I'll talk a little bit about testing again in a minute. So for our 617 test positive cases, 330 of those are in Vancouver Coastal Health, 194 in Fraser Health, 44 now on Vancouver Island Health Authority area, 41 in Interior Health, and 9 in the North. We have as well two additional long-term care or residential care homes that are involved in outbreaks in the Lower Mainland. Of those, we now have the Lynn Valley Care Center has now 42 residents and 21 staff affected. Hollyburn remains with just the single resident and staff. We've had an increase as well at the Harrow Park Lodge with 15 residents and 25 staff people testing positive there. And Fraser Health, we have Delta View and Dufferin Care Centers, both of which just have a single case. And in the German Canadian House in Vancouver Coastal Health, there's continues to be a single staff member affected in that outbreak. So the two new facilities are Little Mountain Place Residential Care in Vancouver Coastal Health and Evergreen Heights in Fraser Health. And in both those cases, a single person, a staff person and a resident in the case of Evergreen Heights have tested positive. And the outbreak protocols are being implemented at both those facilities and continue at the other long-term care and assisted living facilities where we have identified outbreaks. And along that, we've been talking about some of the challenges about staff working at multiple places, and this is a reflection of that fact, and we are doing a concerted effort across the province to now sort that out so that we can assign people to a specific long-term care home, particularly through this outbreak and that or through this pandemic, and that is something that is being undertaken as an urgent issue in the last couple of days, and we expect to have that worked out by the end of the week. I do also want to update you on the numbers of people who have been hospitalized, and currently we have 59 cases hospitalized across the province, and 23 of whom are in intensive care unit. We do not have any additional deaths to report, so we remain at 13 today, and I'll talk about that in a minute. But really, the good news is we now have 173 people who have fully recovered from COVID-19. So that's 28% of our total cases. And I think that's a really positive thing. It shows us that most people, particularly young, healthy people who have milder illness, are able to be managed at home and are recovering from this. And the other positive thing around that is that we're learning from around the world that once you've recovered from this, you have immunity for a period of time, at least for the next few weeks to months, which is really helpful, I think, in encouraging people and supporting people to be able to, if you're a healthcare worker, to safely work with cases of COVID-19. Here in BC, when we talk about the numbers of deaths we've had, I know there's been a lot of comments kind of come in to me that our death rate is very high, and that means that we're on a trajectory that's very similar to countries like or areas of the world like Northern Italy and others. And I just want to put that in a little bit of context. Most of our deaths, tragically, have been related to the one long-term care home, the Lynn Valley Care Home, where the outbreak had been going on for some time before we were able to get a handle on it. So 10 people, 10 of the residents of that facility have died in this outbreak. And that really shows, when we look at the overall numbers and the people who have died from this, we consider that as one event rather than 10 individual events that reflect a number of other cases in the community. It also reinforces the importance of all the work that we need to do to protect our elders and those most vulnerable, particularly in our long-term care and assisted living facilities around the province. I have also heard some media reports, and I know there's been quite a lot about this recently, about a dentist and who had attended the Pacific Dental Conference, who recently passed away. That person was known to public health and was associated with the Pacific Dental Conference. The public health investigation had been done, so the contacts of that person, any close contacts, were identified and were put into isolation. And the anybody who was at risk from exposure to this individual was identified. It is tragic that he passed away, and I understand the coroner is investigating, and we do not have any more information at the moment about his death. But in the circumstances, once the circumstances are confirmed, I'll be able to share that with you. I will share as well that, you know, this conference is a major source of some of the infections that we've been seeing in BC. There are now up to 32 people that we can link directly or indirectly to that conference. All of those people attending the conference were notified of a positive case who was there and asked to self-isolate. And then as soon as we realized that there was additional people who were associated with that conference coming down with the disease, we advised them all, everybody who had attended, to self-isolate, not just to monitor themselves for symptoms. And a number of people have come forward since then because of that. I will also say that I have provided advice to all of the regulatory colleges about the actions that their members should be taking in the community right now to reduce the risk of transmission of COVID-19 in our community settings. So that includes chiropractors, dentists, physicians, nurses, anybody who works in our community, massage therapists, who fall under the regulatory framework of the health, the Regulated Health Professions Act. And that advice is to minimize any physical contact and to reduce your practice to emergency services only. And there's some more details about that that we can provide. I will note that the Dental College, soon after the conference and the notification that we gave for people to self-isolate, the Dental College had also provided advice to dentists that they should cease all but emergency dental services in the community given the pandemic. And I think in some people's mind, those two messages became confusing. So in order to ensure that that's very clear for people who are practicing in the community, I have drafted, I sent a letter out to all of the colleges about the expectations that we have about safe practice at this point in time. I talked a little bit about our strategy and our strategy around testing. So we have a very worked out public health strategy for why we do testing in a certain way, how we've changed our testing, and it really has been looking at what is happening around the world, understanding and being informed by how things are being done in other countries, and being nimble in our response. So to be clear, we are absolutely testing and contact tracing anybody for whom we don't know the source of their infection. And that's the important thing. We talk a lot, I talked many times about the fact that we know the source of infection for people who are coming in from outside of Canada. And since we had the travel advisory in place, and since we put the order that everybody who's come in from outside of Canada must self-isolate for 14 days, if they do become sick, we know the source of their infection, and we don't need to have them go out of their house to go someplace to be tested, maybe exposing other people. We assume that they have this disease, and we manage them accordingly, and we make sure that they don't have contacts and pass it on to others. So that's how we break those chains of transmission. And that allows us to focus on the community cases where we do not know the source of infection. So as you will know, we've done almost 30,000 tests. We've got our backlog where we had a lot of testing being done without a strategy. We've got that all through, and that's reflected in the numbers that you've seen yesterday and today. But now this allows us to continue to widely test anybody for whom we don't have an idea where they came in contact with this. So that's community cases that are involved with a cluster or an outbreak, or community cases that have arisen is part of our surveillance. It also means that we can aggressively test healthcare workers in our health system, as well as the long-term care residents and healthcare workers, so that we can manage outbreaks and protect our healthcare system. So that is the change in the strategy that we've had around testing. It's based on what they're doing in other countries. And when we talk about test, the focus is on making sure that we can identify where cases are coming up where we don't have a known source. And that's what we're focusing on right now. And finally, this is a reflection of the fact that we are seeing escalating numbers across British Columbia. We know that there is circulation and there is risk across the province right now. The majority of our cases are in the Lower Mainland, but no community in this province is immune. And we know this virus can spread with people having very minimal symptoms. And that is our rationale for making sure that we all take these physical distancing measures that we've been talking about in the last little while. The way we break the chains of transmission are making sure that we're not close enough that this virus can spread between people. So we're doing everything we can right now, and we need you to do the same as well. So we will get through this. You know, none of us needs to get this virus. And that's where these physical distancing is so important. And extra important is, not only do we not need to get it, we don't need to bring it home and give it to our parents or our grandparents or other people in our family, in our community, who may have serious illness from this virus. So physical distance is incredibly important right now for all of us. And I know most people are doing their very best at this, and we can see that in our community right now. But the other part of it is ensuring that we maintain our social connections. And that is what's going to get us through this. So I encourage everybody to take those virtual connections with your family, with older people in your community. Don't have that physical contact, but maintain those social connections. That will protect our elders, our seniors. That will protect our healthcare system. And that will get us through the next few weeks.
Thank you, Dr. Henry. And as Dr. Henry has noted, today's report shows an escalating number of confirmed cases in British Columbia. And an escalating number of cases of people currently in hospital, currently in ICU, and the seriousness with which the struggle that British Columbia is facing. That's 617 cases, of course, and Dr. Henry has laid it out by health authority, but what it shows is that no part of our province is immune, and that everyone has to take the steps that Dr. Henry has recommended to prepare and to avoid for the spread of COVID-19. I wanted to bring you up to date on progress with respect to occupancy in BC hospitals and acute care hospitals in BC. We have added more now available beds that are available due to our efforts to both move people out of hospital who do not need to be there. And so there are now 3,866 available beds. That our current occupancy is about 66%, or 2 in 3 beds currently filled, and that compares to what is ordinarily the case, which is about 103.5%. And currently, in terms of our critical care occupancy, that rate is 55.3% across BC hospitals at the present time, which is roughly what it was yesterday, and of course less than it was last week and at any time before that. I think that reflects, as I noted yesterday, and Dr. Henry has noted, the seriousness of the situation, the preparations being made in our acute care hospitals, and we continue to do that work every day in order to both prepare our acute care hospitals in terms of resources and also to prepare our staff in terms of the challenging days to come. Dr. Henry has reflected, I think, on the extraordinary work of the BC CDC, and I just wanted to reflect on this a bit myself, that 3,500 tests is what we're doing every day, which is an extraordinary increase. It reflects the work and the leadership of the BC CDC, which has been unbelievably valuable to all British Columbians in dealing with these issues. It's really courageous and heroic work by people who have given everything they have to give us the means to deal with COVID-19. And with them, partners who are processing tests around the province, such as Life Labs, and then partners through the health authorities who have been assisting with that as well. This allows us to expand our testing capacity and to do and to follow the direction, the science-based direction of Dr. Henry. I wanted to also acknowledge the extraordinary work that's taking place in long-term care, led by those that represent management long-term care, and also unions in long-term care, in particular the Hospital Employees Union and others, who've done just remarkable things and are doing remarkable things to, in effect, reorganize the way significant parts of long-term care have been organized for some time in order to protect patients. It's extraordinary work. They've been all in on it, and we very much appreciate their work and the work of the BCNU and the HSA, doctors of BC and resident doctors of BC, and other health professions such as pharmacists and midwives, who are every day stepping up to provide care and service, and we are so appreciative and so respectful. We launched an app yesterday that has had so far about 20,000 downloads, which is a significant success. We're seeing about 1,000 downloads each hour today, and I encourage people to check out that app. We received some questions through social media and other areas about advertising, so I wanted to say a few things about that, that the priority is to ensure that people have information they need during the COVID-19 pandemic. It's why we do daily briefings and many media interviews and share our messages extensively in multiple languages around BC. As you know, buying advertising requires booking weeks or months in advance. And since the declaration of the pandemic, our Crown corporations and government have been reviewing the ads they have in market and are pulling many of them. ICBC, for example, has proactively pulled its campaign on the changes to make ICBC more affordable. And our focus is on health information. Our focus is on COVID-19. And you will see that in the days to come reflected in new advertising. So I just wanted to make that point. Finally, I just wanted to say that we spoke yesterday about how this is going to be a struggle for weeks and for months ahead of us, that it's not going to end anytime soon. There's not a quick fix, although the measures we are all taking now, will play a significant role in the outcome and why we have to continue 100% of our effort. There is no chance we'll beat this if we leave the work to others. that each of us doesn't play our role. We need everyone to. We must take care, all of us. The number of cases we've been seeing will continue to rise. It will. The next few weeks will be very, very difficult. It will be some time before we see the change we are all working towards, but what happens today matters in that change. What matters today matters in April and in the months that follow that. And we must make the effort now so that those efforts will pay off. Defeating this virus demands that we stay physically apart from each other. The battle that we need to wage to defeat the virus demands that we come closer together as a community. And I see that happening every day in the community I live in and across BC. It's essential we continue to work together, that we trust one another, that we rely on one another. It's why we brief and we get provide information every day to British Columbians about what's going on so they understand and people understand what's going on. We must be united because we all have a duty to deliver. What we need to deliver is what Dr. Henry has put forward to you today and in previous days. 100% compliance, 100% of us, 100% of the time. And in our fight against COVID-19 today and all days ahead, we must continue to be 100% all in. Aujourd'hui, nous vous donnons des mises à jour des cas sur deux périodes de 24 heures, le 22 au 23 mars et le 23 mars à 14 heures aujourd'hui. Au cours de la première période de déclaration jusqu'au 23 mars, nous avons eu 67 nouveaux cas, pour un total de 535 cas en Colombie-Britannique. Au cours des dernières 24 heures, nous avons 78 nouveaux cas pour un total de 617 cas en Colombie-Britannique. Ça fait dans les deux jours depuis notre dernière présentation, 145 nouveaux cas. Parmi les nouveaux cas, un patient est un travailleur de la santé au foyer de soins en résidence Little Mountain Place dans la région de santé de Vancouver Coastal. Chaque région de santé maintenant compte des patients atteints de COVID-19. C'est 330 à Vancouver Coastal, 194 à Fraser, 44 sur l'île de Vancouver, 41 à l'intérieur et 8 au nord. Au total, il y a eu 13 décès dus à COVID-19 en Colombie-Britannique. De plus, sur le total des cas de COVID-19, 59 personnes sont actuellement hospitalisées, dont 23 sont en soins intensifs et les autres personnes qui ont été testées positives pour COVID-19 se rétablissent à la maison pour l'isolement. Nous sommes très heureux d'annoncer que 28% des cas, soit 173 personnes, sont désormais rétablies et ne sont plus isolées. Merci beaucoup. Thank you. And we'll take your questions now.